Good evening. Welcome to Left, Right and Center. On the show tonight, the black fungus, how prohibitively expensive treatment may be the only way for many to treat this frightening post-COVID health scare, which is now being treated as an epidemic. On this show, India's leading experts on what we know so far. Also on the show tonight, the evidence is absolutely clear. With two vaccines, even doctors working on COVID patients are well protected. We bring you the latest data from two giant healthcare chains, Max and Apollo. We tell you what it exactly shows. The message is important. You just have to vaccinate. And without vaccinating, people in our country are just not protected. They are just not safe. But first, our top story today. The government has asked all states to declare mucormycosis or black fungus an epidemic. A letter from the Health Ministry asks states to list under the Epidemic Diseases Act the rare but potentially fatal infection. Here are reports with several details.
63-year-old Kishore Punjabi recovered from COVID but was attacked by a fungal infection, mucormycosis, that forced doctors at a private hospital in Mumbai to surgically remove his right eye and underlying dead tissue.
Operation around 12-1 baje chalu hua rahega, kareeban 4 baje tak operation khatam hua, to usme unka ek aankh nikala aur sinus ka pura part जो सड़ा हुआ था स्कल बेस तक जाके वो निकाल के क्लियर किया.
With hundreds of such cases of mucormycosis or black fungal disease that affects the eyes, nose, jaws and could even spread to the brain being reported across the country, the center has asked states to notify it under the Epidemic Diseases Act. Notifying mucormycosis under the Epidemic Diseases Act will mean that every government hospital, private facility or medical college will have to notify the health authorities on all suspected and confirmed cases. That will give clarity on the total number of such cases and the government will be able to better plan allocation of the antifungal drugs which are right now in very short supply. The ICMR health authorities will also give guidelines on how to screen, diagnose and manage the disease. The center has said black fungus has become a new challenge reported among COVID patients on steroid therapy and deranged sugar control and is leading to prolonged morbidity and mortality. Already, Maharashtra has reported 1500 cases and 90 deaths.
Mucormycosis manjej kali burshi ya kharya arthani fungal disease mule rajyamade ekun अंदाजे 1500 पेशंट्स प्रोग्रेसिव म्हणजे आतापर्यंत आपल्याला पाहायला मिळतात.
गुजरात इज सस्पेक्टेड टू हॅव 600 केसेस, 420 इन मध्य प्रदेश, वाइल तेलंगणा हॅज नियरली 300 केसेस. कर्नाटक अँड राजस्थान हॅव बोथ रिपोर्टेड 100 केसेस ईच. इन दिल्ली देर आर अन एस्टिमेटेड 250 केसेस अँड अ प्रायव्हेट हॉस्पिटल हॅज रिपोर्टेड 1 डेथ.
So far, we have treated 5 cases of black fungus, and out of those 5 cases, 2 patients were very severely affected, and one of them, although both were operated, one of them lost the life because it was at unsalvageable stage and we could not save the patient.
Assam reported its first case of a 27-year-old patient who recovered from COVID without going to the ICU but was severely diabetic and succumbed to the fungal disease on Wednesday. With huge shortage reported in antifungal drugs like liposomal amphotericin, Telangana, for instance, has constituted a government panel to regulate supply and stop black marketing. With inputs from Pooja Bharadwaj in Mumbai, Parimal in Delhi, Ratnadeep in Guwahati, Uma Sudhir in Hyderabad for NDTV.
Well, joining us now, some of India's leading specialists on mucormycosis and the threat it represents. Dr. Manish Munjal, Senior ENT and Consultant at Sir Gangaram. Dr. Sumit Mrig, Principal Consultant and Head ENT at Max Smart Super Specialty Hospital. Dr. Ravi Kiran Vernekar, ENT and Head and Neck Surgeon at Dr. Hiranandani Hospital in Mumbai. And Dr. Amar Agarwal, Chairman and Managing Director of Dr. Agarwal's Eye Hospital and Eye Research Center. Thank you all very much for being with us. As usual, we've got a couple of questions listed out. Dr. Munjal, you know, at Sir Gangaram Hospital, we've seen any number of cases. So my first question to you, at what stage does the black fungus, as it's known, start getting life-threatening?
Well, unfortunately, very fast. There is no real time to it. But if you talk by the pathway, the nose and the eye till that time, or the teeth from where it starts. It may still be controllable to some extent till that time when it is recoverable. But once it crosses these barriers and goes into the tissues of the back of the eye, which we call the orbital apex, that is the pathway from which the fungus usually travels into the part of the brain called the cavernous sinus. And the cavernous sinus are joined towards both the sides of blood structure, and it passes from one side back of the eye to the other. That gives it the typical black color of and the swelling in both the eyes. That is the time when we can say that the disease has actually become very life-threatening. And once you see that stage in a patient, it's usually a go-go situation, and you can't save the patient after that. But with very high antifungals, you may still try.
All right. Dr. Agarwal, how fast does the disease progress?
The problem here is this. When you have this mucormycosis, it is normally present, but because of injudicious use of steroids or immunity coming down because of diabetes or extra oxygen, what's happening here is...
Doctor, I'm just interrupting you because we just need to fix your sound, and we'll fix that and come back to you in a moment. Dr. Wernicke, do you want to take that question? How soon, how fast does it progress, the disease? And what are the symptoms?
So to answer your this question, Vishnu, I will tell you, see, what COVID does is, COVID basically attacks the hemoglobin, the red blood cells, okay? So in that, what it does is, it breaks down the, it is basically hungry for ferrous iron, okay, in the hemoglobin. So when it starts attacking the hemoglobin, this ferrous ion is converted into ferric ion, okay? And we must understand the mucor, the fungus which we are talking about, is equally hungry for ferric ion, okay? So it needs ferric ion to survive in the blood and the tissues. And as you know, we already come to know that, you know, it is the sugar, the blood sugar, the high blood sugar, which is equally responsible. This combination of high blood sugar and the ferric ion makes a good solution for the mucor to survive and to multiply. So this multiplication, we should understand, happens in the blood vessels. So basically this mucor fungus attacks the blood vessels and starts destroying it. Okay, so once a particular blood vessel is destroyed, so see, this mucor fungus is basically inhaled fungus. As we know that this fungus is there everywhere. Indoor, outdoor, you have some old stuff in your house, you know, some fruits or food which is rotting, everywhere the fungus is there. So when these people, you know, these high people with high risk inhale this fungal immediately attacks the cells of the nasal mucosa.
Right.
And then it destroys the blood vessels. The moment it destroys the blood vessels, the circulation is lost. Okay. And it's a very common theory, everybody knows, you know, for any cells to remain vital, blood circulation is very important.
Yeah.
So the tissue becomes necrotic, and once the tissue becomes necrotic, the adjacent cells doesn't receive the blood vessels. So it goes on spreading. It's very fast, you know. I can say 24 to 72 hours is the time where the spread can just go from nowhere to, you know, total destruction of the tissues.
Okay.
But you know, 72 hours is what we should think, because you know, the 72 hours is a multiplication for any
sure.
fungus.
Okay. So it does spread very fast. Dr. Mrigg, my next question is to you. How expensive is the treatment of black fungus?
See, for mucormycosis, the best treatment, once you have diagnosed a patient with mucormycosis, based on KOH staining, which you can take a swab, or through a radiology, or the signs and symptoms, the clinical symptoms, the patient needs to be immediately admitted. The most important is controlling the blood sugar levels, because the blood sugar level, if they are not controlled, then it will be difficult to control the spread of the fungus. And like Dr. Munjal said, in about 24 to 48 hours, you can have involvement of the orbit and to the brain. So the first step is to control the blood sugar levels. The second step is to start a patient on IV amphotericin B. Now, this is a life-saving drug which should be started as soon as the diagnosis of mucormycosis is made. Now, amphotericin B drug comes in about 3 to 4 formulations, which is available in the country. The problem with amphotericin B is that in patients who have got renal problems, like whose have got increased blood urea and creatinine. They are on dialysis. They are renal transplant patients. They are immunocompromised patients. Their renal functions are not good. They can't receive the basic amphotericin B, which is amphotericin B deoxycholate, because it causes the renal functions to deteriorate very fast. Because you need to start these patients on little high doses if the mucormycosis is grown up. If these patients, on another hand, we have liposomal amphotericin B, which is one of the most safe drugs if we compare all the four formulations. Liposomal amphotericin B cost about 30 to 40,000 per day to a patient.
Right.
And if a patient has got very extensive mucormycosis, like it has gone into the orbit, it has gone on to the going to the brain, then in spite of a good surgery and debridement, the patient generally needs this IV treatment for about 3 to 4 weeks, followed by oral treatment of either delayed release posaconazole or isavuconazole. That is also available as an IV also, which can be given. And these are expensive treatments. So in patients who have got a good renal profile, they can still get away with the basic amphotericin B, which does not cost much, maybe about 3,000 per day. But people with poor renal profile, see, we must understand mucormycosis is a disease of immunocompromised people.
Right.
We are receiving, in the last about 4 days, we have done about 14 surgeries. We have received about 25 to 30 patients. Most of the people are in the age group of 50 to 60 years of age.
Am I correct to understand, doctor, that, you know, it could be at a private hospital, obviously, between 15
yes.
to 30 lakhs in terms of basic treatment inclusive of surgery?
I would not say 15 to 30 lakhs. 7 to 10 lakhs is you can expect if a patient gets a surgery, if a patient stays for about 7 to 10 days, if a patient receives liposomal amphotericin B. But if a patient is young, in about 35 to 40 or 45, 50, the blood glucose level is controlled, the kidney functions are fine, then it is not that an expensive
sure.
treatment. But the important thing is, I must highlight, to catch the disease in the early.
All right, and we'll talk about that. I just want to go across to Dr. Wernicker and with my next question. How complicated is surgery to deal with black fungus?
Yeah, so generally what happens is, you know, as the spread is very fast, here you see the disease is first attacking the nasal tissues. But since the eye is very close, brain is very close, it spreads very fast. So here you can see, you know, you involve not just the ENT specialist, you involve an ophthalmologist, you end up involving the, you know, neurosurgeon. Probably, you know, the patient is so sick, you know, the patient needs total 24 hours monitoring in the intensive care unit. And, you know, the drugs are not available, drugs are expensive. So, you know, see, if you see all these factors, you know, and then plus, you know, it's not that you operate once and the patient is recovered. You may have to take for multiple. See, when you first operate a patient, the situation may be looking that, you know, the disease is very much limited. And then you may feel that, you know, you may save the eye. And then you operate that particular part. Because, you know, see, when a person is having a mild vision, then you are doubtful whether you save the eye or whether you come out of it, you know. Then, you know, you operate. And then, you know, after 2 days, you see that microscopically the disease has progressed. And then you find after 2 days, you know, that the patient has lost the vision. And you take him back for the another surgery.
Right.
So this is something, you know, which we never faced before in this alarming, you know, situation, you know.
Yeah,
see,
no,
there were days, you know.
Yeah,
yeah,
no, it's very, very yeah. frightening indeed. I just wanted to go back to Dr. Agarwal. You know, you were making an important point, and this is actually one of the key questions which have been asked. It's a question is, what is the link between high steroid use and black fungus?
You see, Vishnu, what's the problem here is this. The eyes are a part of the brain. So when someone gets immunocompromised by using steroids, and one of the problems, patients, I tell them not to WhatsApp treatment of themselves. There are doctors to go to. When they medicate, that is the problem. And that is not. So what happens? What nasal sinus get involved, the eyes get involved, the brain gets involved, which is the problem.
Okay, doctor, you know, we're just having these problems with your sound is once again, we need to fix that. Dr. Munjal, would you like to take this very specific question on steroid use and this illness? What is the link?
Well, the entire immunity of the body is dependent on the blood cells, which contain the macrophages, the neutrophils as a part of the humoral and furthermore in the tissue as T helper cell immunity. Now, what happens is when there's a mucosal breach, the skin of the nasal mucosa, the teeth gets broken, the spores enter and are deposited there, and the macrophages and all in a slow time are able to reach up to it, but they are not able to destroy this because they are so slow. Because of steroids, they have been made immobile, and the spores then they start germinating into hyphae inside your own body tissues, which can never happen in an immunocompetent person because the spores will be killed by these cells in no time. But since these cells are so slow that these spores are germinating, and once they start germinating, they start releasing their toxins. They enter and invade the blood vessels. They cause small little microthrombi, and they start causing gangrene. That's why it's called black fungus, because it causes a blackening. And if you block an artery here, it'll cause a gangrene into the entire vascular area of that skin. So it just goes on and on. And of course, the fungus is also progressing along with that further. What happens is in no time, you have the optic nerve involved, which is supplied by a single artery called the central retinal artery. It blocks off and your vision gets conked off in minutes. It cannot be revived. It's just like the heart. You cannot revive the central retinal artery after a few minutes. And then, of course, the brain goes into the internal carotid system. It can lead to various painful multiple infarcts. So many people, we might not have reported deaths right now, but there are so many on the ventilators now. They are not never going to come back who've got this into the brain. So it's a lost battle after that. But it is exactly at the point, that's what the steroids do. They make the entry of the fungus easier into the body, and there is no resistance offered to it. That's the problem.
All right. Well, this is all very, very frightening. If COVID wasn't bad enough.
One small little point.
Go ahead. Briefly, sir. Yeah.
What happens is the steroid, they have to be tapered fast. Once you are fighting this fungus, even if you needed the steroids, you have to taper them fast because they take time for the immunity to come back. And in that time, you lose the battle. So you have to stop the
steroids. All right. So the importance of tapering, and I appreciate it and like to thank you, gentlemen, very much for being with us. We'll track that very, very closely. On now to another focus this evening. And this is positive. Data collated by Max Healthcare shows that double vaccination doses do indeed work. This at a time when the Indian Medical Association has said the 329 doctors have died in COVID in India in just the second wave. And the main reason, they say, is not being vaccinated. Here's a report of how the benefits of vaccination are there to see. It's data. Take a look.
Dr. Shekhar Agarwal, one of Delhi's best-known orthopedic surgeons, in the days before he died after getting COVID. He was one among 244 doctors who died during this phase of COVID, but one of just seven to be fully vaccinated, according to the Indian Medical Association. Now, in a large study, Max Healthcare has stated that there is no doubt that double doses do work and save lives. The Max Healthcare study showed that only 6% of the number of people who had received both jabs were infected, 9 of them recovered at home, and 1 required hospitalization. Apollo Healthcare, in a smaller study, found similar results during the first 100 days of the vaccination drive. The study covered 3,235 healthcare workers, of whom 2,481 had received both doses. 97% of those vaccinated were protected from the infection, and there were no ICU admissions or deaths. IMA President Dr. Jayalal says that based on the data that they have received, not being fully vaccinated is the main cause behind the deaths. These resident doctors at the All India Institute of Medical Sciences, or AIIMS, want to be inoculated immediately. Some of them have not received even a single jab.
जितने भी रेजिडेंट डॉक्टर्स हैं उनको वॉक इन रजिस्ट्रेशन मिल रहा था वो एक आई कार्ड लेके जा रहे थे इवन आई कार्ड के साथ बीच में एम्प्लॉई सर्टिफिकेट भी मांगा जो कि एचओडी से साइन करके जाते और वैक्सीन उनको लग जाती लेकिन अभी 4-5 दिनों से क्या है कि उनको मना कर दिया गया है कि फर्स्ट डोज का जो है आपको रजिस्ट्रेशन नहीं होगा वॉक इन एंड अगर बात करें 18-45 ईयर्स की एज ग्रुप वाले आते हैं उसका स्लॉट एम्स दिल्ली के अंदर तो वैसे भी कोविड सेंटर को नहीं दे रखा था
इट इज नॉट जस्ट डॉक्टर्स अकॉर्डिंग टू द यूनियन हेल्थ मिनिस्ट्री ओनली 66% of India's healthcare workers have been fully vaccinated, despite being declared frontline and cleared to receive the first jabs when the vaccination drive began on January 16. In New Delhi, with Vishnu Shom and camera person Sushil Rathi, this is Sukirti Dwivedi for NDTV.
Well, joining us now, Dr. Sandeep Hudiraja, the Group Medical Director of Max Healthcare, and Professor Anupam Sibal, who's the Group Medical Director of the Apollo Hospitals Group. Let me come to you first, Dr. Hudiraja. How have you, could you tell us a little bit about the data that you have collected with two doses? How safe are your doctors and frontline workers?
So we have been able to completely vaccinate with two doses about 14,000 employees of ours spread across various network hospitals. What we found, and this is the data starting 16th January when the first phase for healthcare workers inoculation started. And we have been collecting this data till about, the data of course collection is ongoing, but the data which we have collected is up till last week. So it covers the peak from third week of April till May. So what we found out of these 14,000 healthcare workers, about 855 tested positive for COVID in terms of being symptomatic for COVID infection. So that's about 6% of the employee base which was vaccinated. Further, we wanted to drill down of these 6%, that's about 855 people who got the infection, how many had mild or moderate or severe infection. And what we found was 90% of these, that's about 768, had very mild infection and just needed to self-isolate at home. Or in some cases like nurses, we had to sort of put them in institutional quarantine. About 86 employees, that's about 10%, were the ones who had symptoms sufficient to require hospitalization. But all of them, 100% of them, had an uneventful recovery and all got discharged. Unfortunately, we had one senior clinician who had some comorbidities who needed to be shifted to ICU, and he sadly succumbed to the illness. So out of, I would say, 14,000, 865 developed infection and only one succumbed. So overall, I think the vaccine has been very effective in terms of either preventing infections in large numbers or at least reducing the severity in those who contracted the illness to make it a very mild illness. And that's sure. where I think the emphasis and focus on complete vaccination for COVID, if we have to get an end to this pandemic, lies.
No, absolutely. Dr. Sibal, now your study at Apollo was a little bit earlier. The time period was a bit earlier. What were some of the key findings?
Hi, Vishnu. Pleasure to be with you. So we looked at Apollo Delhi. As you know, we are India's largest healthcare provider in the private sector. And of course, we are looking at data for 33,000 Apollo family members across 16 states. And that data should be ready in a week. But what we looked at was data with one vaccine, Covishield, for 3,235 Apollo family members at Apollo Delhi. And what we found was really encouraging. 85 of them, which is 2.6%, actually had an infection, and only two needed an admission. So when you look at 2/3, 2/6, 5, it works out to be 0.06%. So that's really, really very encouraging. And no one went into the ICU, no one died. The message out here is that vaccination prevents serious complications, it prevents progression to an ICU stay, and prevents death. Now, if you get a mild infection and you can manage that at home in isolation, then that's fine. And that's how we're going to get on top of this epidemic, this pandemic, really. So what we need to give out as a message here is go get vaccinated, get your two doses. But please do remember that after that, you will decrease the risk of serious infection, but not getting infected. So please have SMS, and that is something that you cannot forget. And also, another point to remember is that for 2 weeks after the second dose is when the immunity really kicks in.
Sure.
It'll be very interesting to see what we get out of our 33,000 cohort of family members across the country.
When is that coming out?
That's slightly later. Some of those, some of those who got vaccinated sure. when the second wave was on. So it'll be very interesting to see. I anticipate that some of the numbers will be higher. But fortunately, this vaccine, both the vaccines seem to be doing the job that they were designed to.
This is important. I mean, it's great to be hearing this. You know, I mean, it's just wonderful to be hearing that the vaccine, that's nothing more that we wanted to hear. But Dr. Hudiraja, a question which emerges is this, the strain, B.1.7.1.6.2, B.1.7.1.6, then the UK strain as well, which was also in India, no longer perhaps the dominant strain. Basically, the vaccine works on all the strains so far, right? I mean, is that the conclusion that we can draw?
See, at the same time at Max Healthcare, we are doing a very interesting study of trying to study people who have been vaccinated. What's the prevalence of infection or incidence of infection in these? And that's not restricted, limited to healthcare workers. And at the same time, we are also trying to study the effectiveness of one shot and also the chances of getting a reinfection or a relapse infection in people who have had infection prior to 90 days. And of course, trying to study a subset of healthy cohort of people. And we are sort of tied up with IGIB, which is CSIR, to see and do a genetic sequencing or genotyping of these samples, RNA samples, which we have with us, to see what's the predominant strain. And very interesting, very initial data of the samples which we have sent to IVIG is almost all of these samples have tested positive for the mutation. And that's B1.617.1.2, except maybe very, very minimal samples where they have identified the UK strain. So I would say 90% is this Indian mutant strain. Now, interestingly, if we correlate that to our study, so that clearly means that vaccine is giving protection against even this mutant strain, though there would be some cases of sort of an immune escape or even in spite of having vaccination, you may still get the infection. But I think that clearly there is a response, a partial protection, may not be 100% protection, but protection enough to prevent a severe disease.
Dr. Muthiraja, just a very, in 30 seconds only I have left, a quick clarification. When you say that you've done genetic sequencing, are you saying that you've done genetic sequencing of a large number of these cases, of the data that you have studied?
Yeah, so this data would be a subset of that population, and that's an ongoing study. Right now, we are sending, like, let's say 5-7 samples to them every day, and we keep getting the result on a weekly basis. So it's a very, very initial data, and we ultimately plan to have almost 250 people enrolled for this. It will be a subset of our healthcare workers, plus the other people who are coming and have a clear history of having either been vaccinated or having had infection in past. So that's a subset we want to focus on.
And when would you have statistically relevant or large data for this? You know,
yeah,
just to see if the vaccine works on the mutation numerically.
Yeah. So we are doing genetic sequencing and we are doing T cell studies also. So the entire study will take few weeks, I think 6 to 8 weeks at least for it to come out.
Okay.
But the initial data clearly shows high prevalence of mutant strain in Delhi region.
All right. I'd like to thank you both very much for joining us. I think the message from all of us over here, keep being vaccinated. Yes, it's frustrating sometimes to get the vaccine because of the lack of it at the moment. But vaccination is what's going to save our country from this. We just need to have much more of that. Out of time.